I guess it's safe to say that I have a bit of a fascination with red dots on handguns. So welcome back, everybody. Hope you guys have been doing awesome. Sorry I haven't uploaded a video in a while. I've just been getting distracted with family stuff. But nonetheless, we're here today, so let's do this. I wanted to talk about 6 or 7 different things that you should know before you mount a red dot onto your handgun, especially if you've never done this before. If you've done this before, you might know some of these mistakes. But when I got into handguns 5, 6 years ago now, I didn't know any of this stuff, and I just kind of had to learn the hard way. So hopefully this video will help you in not having to make the same mistakes I did. And the reason I wanted to make this video is because there's a lot of things that you can do that, you know, could really, you know, mess up your day, not in so much in the way that it shoots, but in the way of wasting money and stuff like that. I'll give you just a quick story. In 2016, I think it was like fall of 2016, I had only been on YouTube for about 6 months or so, and I was doing a giveaway. And on the giveaway, I got these companies together. I got Vortex Optics to give away the Vortex Viper because that had just come out. And I got a guy to give away a slide package, you know, where someone sends in their slide when they do the cuts on it, mount the optic to it, all that good stuff. And then I had somebody give away, I think, a trigger, and then I had someone give away stippling. Anyway, the gentleman that won it, when he sent his slide off to have it milled, he wrote out this, you know, letter to the CNC guy, and he said, "Hey, I'm the winner of the giveaway. You know, I won the Vortex, I won this, I won the stippling, all that cool stuff." And then he went on to say, "You know, these are the cuts that I want on the gun." And then he said, "I want the RMR cut." A few weeks later, when the guy was done with it and he shipped it back to the guy, this guy is like blowing up my email because the machine shop cut it for a Trijicon RMR and not a Vortex Viper. And the guy at the machine shop said, "Well, your note says you want an RMR cut." And the other guy goes, "Well, I did say earlier in the email that I had a Vortex Viper." And then the machine shop said, "Yes, I saw that, but I figured maybe you had a Trijicon RMR you wanted to mount. That's why you're asking for an RMR cut." Nonetheless, long story short, it was kind of a fault on both of them. But that's the kind of things that a lot of people don't know if you've never gotten into this before. And that's the kind of stuff I wanted to cover in today's video. So I think probably the first thing to consider whenever you're going to put a red dot onto a handgun is, what handgun do you have, and or what handgun do you intend to get to put a red dot on? Traditionally, there's 3 ways you can mount a red dot to a handgun, and it all depends on what the purpose of the gun is. So if you're considering a red dot to do competition shooting, maybe you have like a 2011 that you want to competition shoot with, maybe you have a Glock 34, maybe you have a Sig Sauer Legion X5. I mean, there's way more competition guns than just those. Those are just a couple that I had off the cuff. But I'm just saying, traditionally the way that those sights work is they will mount up to your Picatinny section here, and then they will take a bridge that goes over your slide here. That way, when you're shooting and pressing out, the optic remains completely still. Now, if you're on the fence about red dots and you're not sure what you want to do or what you want to try, you can do what's called a dovetail mount. I know they make them for Glocks. I'm sure they're available for other guns. I'll actually put together a build list for parts and accessories and everything that I'm mentioning in today's video. In case you want to check them out, maybe pick some up for yourself. The way to find the build list, follow the first link in the description of the video. That'll take you to a separate page where this video is also hosted, and that's where the build list will be with links and promo codes and all that cool stuff in case you're looking for a dovetail mount or, you know, any of the red dots. But anywho, the dovetail mounts, I have tried them. I didn't like them. The dovetail mounts are effective. The only problem that I had with the one that I tested was when you add the dovetail mount into it and then put the red dot on it, depending on the red dot that you use and depending on the weight of that red dot, it could slow down the cycling of your slide or prevent it from coming all the way back. And then with that one, I just experienced a lot of malfunctions. If you are going to run something like that, you're going to need like a slide that has lightning cuts and all that stuff in it. That way it can reciprocate faster. I really don't recommend them, but if you are on the fence and maybe you have a buddy that has a red dot that you could test, you could just pick one of those up, slide it in, and then decide later if you want to permanently mount it to your gun. The next way that you can mount it is directly to your slide. And there's a couple of ways you can go about this. A red dot can be mounted to virtually any gun. I mean, honestly, I've seen them on high points. Basically, you just gotta find somebody that knows how to cut it out on your slide. I mean, I'm sure that someone's even done it to a Taurus G2C. I'm not sure, I haven't seen it. It's probably not as common, but I'm sure it can be done. In that instance, what you'll do is you'll take your OEM slide, you'll put it in the mail, ship it off to a machining company, and then they will, you know, mill out the slide for the optic that you want. It's really important to tell them the exact model of your red dot for the reasons that I mentioned earlier. Whenever you're getting a red dot mounted to a slide, you're gonna have a couple of options, especially with Glocks. You can get the rear dovetail on behind the RMR, or you can actually get it where it's in front of the RMR. And both of them have pros and cons. The pros of having it in the back is, let's just say you decided you're not gonna run a red dot anymore. You could take the red dot off. You put your cover plate back on so that there's not the big divot missing. And now you can shoot it like a normal gun, right? You get that normal sight alignment. The only difference is you're running suppressor height sights so you can co-witness with it. I like that. I like having options to go back and forth. Whereas with, if you get it with the sights mounted in front of the red dot, the pros of this are, number one, this will protect the glass in case a shell deflects and cracks it. I've actually had that happen, not on a Trigicon or a Holosun, but on this other one from Grace Optics. I actually did a whole video on this, and I actually have a product that I'm gonna talk about in a minute that mitigates that in case you don't put the sights in front of the red dot. But that's kind of the big thing with putting the sight in front of the red dot is it will protect it from brass, and you can also rack it off of tables and stuff with a lot more confidence than you can when it's behind it. The other pro to this, and this is all a personal thing, some people say that they can acquire their target much faster because they're not having to look through the rear sight. They're only having to look through the red dot, and then the sight shows up in front of it. And that is true. That is a big advantage to it. But now the downside is, if I wanna take the red dot off and just run it with irons, I can run it, but now I have this weird looking gun that has a really short sight radius. So personally for me, I prefer them in the rear. They don't bother me. But then again, everybody's different. Now, the next way that you can mount it is getting a gun that's modular optics ready. A couple of guns that come to mind, the Glock MOS line. And actually on this one, this is the thing I'm gonna tell you about later. It actually protects your glass, kind of like having a sight in the front of it, but I have the sights in the rear. It protects the glass, so if you're racking it or the brass deflects, it won't crack. MOS, it comes with all these different mounting plates. And the way that the MOS or most modular optic systems work is, has all these different plates. And then it has like a list of these plates fit these optics and this plate fits these optics. And then you screw down your plate, then you put your red dot on top, mount it down. Now, we're gonna talk more about mounting and stuff here in a minute, because there's a lot of mistakes that can be made there also. I do believe Smith & Wesson with their Core Series, they have a modular optics. I like the Core Series optics a little bit better than MOS. And then I haven't tried the CZ like P10C modular optics, but I hear that they have a good system as well. And the other one that I have is the FN509 Tact. Of the ones that I've tried, this has the best modular optic system that I've ever seen. It has all the different screw links for different types of red dots. It has all the different plates. And the best part about this is it has a system in place so you don't have to put Loctite on your screws. We're gonna talk about that more, you know, when we talk about mounting and stuff, but you gotta put Loctite on your screws on every other gun except for this one. Now the pros of modular optics are, let's say you don't know what red dot you wanna get and you went out and say you bought like a Vortex Viper. But let's say that was you and you have a modular optics gun. Well now, if you could take that optic, you can sell it on eBay or on Craigslist, whatever, go buy a different optic and mount it to the same gun. You don't gotta send off your slide. You don't have to do all that stuff in order to run it the way that you want. Also, typically, not all, I know Glocks don't, but most modular optics guns come with suppressor height sights. Glocks don't, Glocks just come with the standard plastic sights that they all come with. But the Smith & Wesson, I believe, comes with suppressor height sights. I know that the FN509 Tactical comes with Trigicon night sights that are suppressor height. And I don't know what the CZ comes with. I just haven't tested that one yet. And there's other guns that have these. These are just the ones that I'm familiar with. This isn't an exhaustive list of modular optics guns. So that's a lot of pros. Now, what are the cons to modular optics? Sometimes they don't have a plate for the optic that you want. The other bummer to modular optics is your red dot doesn't sit as low as it does when it's mounted directly to the slide. And that's because of the plate that's in between the red dot and your slide. I've heard some reports of people that have like the Glock MOS, for example, have their plates crack either from the recoil of the gun or have them crack from dropping them. Now I have three MOSs. I have one Gen 4 and I have a Gen 5 19 and a Gen 5 17 and I've never had that issue. I believe most of those problems came when Glock first introduced the MOS with the Gen 4. I think that's where all the problems were and then they sorted them out later. Seems to be the protocol for a lot of companies. I have nothing but great experiences with the majority of these optics. What if you have a subcompact single stack like a, you know, M&P Shield or this is a Polymer 81, but a Glock 43, 43X, Glock 48. Well, how do you mount a red dot to those? So traditionally, over the past few years, there was only one red dot available for it from a company called Shield Sights. It was called the Shield Sight RMS. I reviewed it 2 years ago. It was crap, in my humble opinion. And it was very expensive to be crap. So now we have two more options that also utilize the footprint of the Shield Sights RMS, which is the HoloSun 407K/507K. We'll talk about those differences here in a minute. And then we have the Trijicon RMR CC. As an example, this gun here is actually milled for a Shield Sight. You will notice this little notch back here. Sometimes with, depending on the red dot you're putting on, companies will put little notches there and there's holes in the bottom of the red dot and the notches fit into there. So when it's under reciprocation of the slide, it doesn't put all the stress on the screws that are holding it down and it helps it maintain at zero a lot better. The downside to both the HoloSun and the Trijicon is although they have the same footprint, their mounting holes are different. So in the example of this one, the rear holes would have to be grinded completely off and the front holes would have to be shortened just a smidge to fit the HoloSun. Just something to keep in mind. I'm a big fan of the HoloSun and I'm a big fan of the Trijicon. Those are great options for your single stacks. They also fit on the Sig Sauer P365s also. As you can see, just knowing what gun you want to put a red dot on is gonna determine, well, how you're gonna mount it and what type of red dot you're gonna get. I mean, traditionally, if you have any type of double stack, your red dot options are typically gonna be the same. And there's a lot of different versions of red dots, and I'm hoping here in a little while, this video will simplify your choices. So for simplicity's sake, but we're gonna use the Glock for the example of choosing a red dot because it's gonna be simpler that way in regards to everything that I can explain. The first thing you wanna think about is battery life, because the battery is gonna be something that's very important on your decision makings. For example, the size of the battery, the life of the battery, and how is the battery changed? Let's talk about the way that the batteries are changed. With all Trijicons, the reason that these are the smallest red dots that you can get is because they're bottom mounted batteries. And therefore, because they're bottom mounted batteries, this portion right here gets to stay super thin. The downside to it is every time you want to change the battery, you have to remove the red dot from your slide and replace it. The problem with that is number one, once you remove the red dot, it needs to be re-zeroed before you shoot it again. The second problem with that is I can't tell you how many times I have stripped out these screws back here because I have too much Loctite on them and then I have to drill them out. And that's always a bummer. It's just a big pain in the butt to change the battery. But you do get a lot of benefits with it, such as the low profile design. With the HoloSun, for example, this one is actually the old style that you cannot buy anymore, but this one is the new style. This is the HoloSun 507C X2. The X2, the difference between the X2 and the old one, is you now have a side mounted battery, meaning you just take this little screw out, this little tray slides out, and you can replace your battery without ever removing your red dot, which I think is a game changer. Now, traditionally, the only other version that we had was something called a top mounted battery. And this little piece right here would come off and then, you know, your battery comes out the top. The problem with this is look how thick this base is right here in comparison to the Trijicon. Like you see how much thinner that Trijicon is? So, you know, before the X2 came out, I was always a fan of Trijicons because, and I still am a fan of Trijicons. I mean, they're military attested and all that stuff. I always liked Trijicons just because they were just so much lower profile. The problem that I've always had with side mounted batteries is they're a smaller battery size, and that usually leads to shorter battery life. In the example of the X2, they have the 1632 battery, whereas the Trijicon RMR or the old style 507C used the 2032 battery. Typically the battery life was always horrendous. However, because HoloSun has 50,000 hours of battery life, because they have solar panels on the red dot, no longer is that a problem. So I'm a big fan of that. So that's why, you know, battery life, battery size, and the way that the battery is changed is super important. My personal humble opinion right now, the HoloSun X2 is my all-time favorite because of that. The other thing to consider when you're purchasing a red dot is the footprint. Oh man, don't get me started on footprints. I don't know all the footprints of all the red dots. So for example, the Vortex Viper has the same mounting footprint as the Burris Fast Fire 3. And then like I mentioned earlier, this Grace Optics has the same exact footprint as the Romeo 1 from Sig Sauer. And that's all fine and dandy. The problem is, say you're looking up places to send off your slide to be milled. The majority of the people are only gonna cut RMR / HoloSun 5073s. And that's because they both share the same footprint. HoloSun designed their red dots around the Trijicon RMR footprint. Now, a lot of machinists will definitely argue that there is a very, very slight, I'm talking like thousandths of an inch difference in size, but for the most part, they're interchangeable. So what's cool about that, if you have a Glock, let's say you don't want to send your slide off to have it milled, but let's just say you have a non-MOS gun. Well, what are your other options? Well, you can go buy aftermarket slides. And I will tell you this, I have never seen an aftermarket slide that's for a Glock or any other gun. If it's cut for an optic, it's always cut for a Trijicon RMR. I've never seen it cut for anything else. I've never seen them, you know, cut, you know, pre-bought. I'm talking about the kind that you buy, not the kind that you send in. I've never seen them cut for the Vortex. I've never seen them cut for a Romeo. I've never seen them cut for a Burris Fastfire 3. It just doesn't happen. So now if I have a stock Glock that's a non-MOS and I don't want to send off my slide, I can order that slide, and I'll actually have links over at the build list of a lot of my favorite off-the-shelf slides. But now I can choose to either put the HoloSun on it or the Trijicon RMR, and we're good to go. Now, the next thing that I look at is the ruggedness of the design. And I think a really good way to illustrate this is with this Grace Optics thing. Now, Grace Optics is a really cool optic that just tries to solve a problem and then creates a new problem. Immediately, I thought, I could drop it and it'll crack. And I guarantee if something gets in there, it's gonna crack it. Mine, this isn't the one, it's in the video review that I did, got cracked by brass deflecting backwards and hitting it. I mean, it only literally took 5 rounds into the mag and it was cracked. So, you know, because of that, I said, hey, let's just put it on a rifle. You know, that's always fun. The most rugged is definitely gonna be your Trijicon. It's because of this top feature up here. So yeah, it's concaved. That's actually patented. Nobody else can do that. But essentially what it does is if it falls straight down, these two sections take the brunt of the force. In the center, this is the weakest part of the glass. And because that's the part of the glass that sticks up the most. So because of that, they're incredibly durable. The main advantage of this one is, although it can't copy their design because it's patented, the cool thing is they have a way better viewing window. The viewing window is huge when you compare the two together. It's almost comical, but they're still rugged. Like, this thing has been thrown around, all that stuff. It's not failed yet. Now, one more thing about battery life. There is an option from Trijicon that you can get called the dual illuminated ones. I don't remember where I got this one from. I don't remember if someone let me borrow it and they just never wanted it back. But essentially on the top here, it has this little section here that absorbs ambient light, and that's how it's powered. There's no battery to this, which there are pros to that. The downside is, now this one has like a green triangle for a reticle. Not really the right reticle, in my opinion. They have different ones, but the main problem I have with this one is when you're outside in the bright daylight, it's almost invisible. I don't know why. It seems like it should be bright green, but it's not. The other problem that I have with it is if you have a weapon light on and let's say you're looking and it's dark in the room, well, there's no ambient light from up here to rain down and, you know, fill that dual illumination receptacle, I'm gonna call it, And therefore, when you have a light on, the dot doesn't even show up if you're in a dark room. So I just, you know, if you want a range toy, maybe, but they're kind of expensive for range toy red dots. Now, another thing that I look at is the profile of the red dot. Now, when you're comparing the red dots that, you know, we're talking about today, the Trijicon's obviously the smallest, followed by the HoloSun right here is just a little bit bigger. Well, I'm sure you've seen the Aimpoint Acro that came out recently. And the Aimpoint Acro looks pretty crazy, right? However, it has one big advantage. They're now fog proof because they are sealed with nitrogen and they can't fog up on you. That was kind of the point of it. I think they're probably good for military and stuff like that. But for me, for concealed carry, it's a little bit much. And the interesting thing is that whole box isn't any taller than the HoloSun 507C. It just looks crazy because it's this big box looking thing. If you want to, I've never tried one. I'm sure they're fantastic. Aimpoint makes fantastic optics, but that's what I'm talking about when I'm talking about profile. I don't want anything that big, especially for concealed carry. And the main reason that I don't want to carry that is because of the next thing we're going to talk about, which is holster clearance. So if you have, say, any type of holster for your handgun that didn't have a red dot on it, you're probably gonna need a new holster or you're gonna have to modify the holster that you have. So you can see there, like the Kydex has been cut down so that this will clear. So here's an example of a holster that didn't have proper clearance. I mean, it'll go in, but it really gets pushed on right here. And it actually does have some clearance, but it's not good. Personally for me, I've been running these. Main reason I like this, it's super flexible. And also I have this one set up. So if I wanted to run a compensator, I can put a comp on the end of the gun and the comp won't burn me when I reholster. It's also made for the light, but let me show you real fast. Like this is a Glock 19X and the 19X can be a little bit harder to conceal than a normal Glock 19, but you can see here, I'm wearing a blue t-shirt and shorts and I can walk around with 36, 37 rounds on me at all time. And nobody thinks anything of it. And then when I need it, it's just there and I can press out. I have links for some of these holsters over at the build list. That way, if you want to pick them up, it's all there for you. Now, a couple things to consider whenever you're going to mount your red dot to your gun. This is what we wanted to talk about here. If you have an MOS Glock, I really highly recommend this guy. They're called Calculated Kinetics, and they have these things called the dog tag. They're about $50, but these are mounting plates for the MOS for both the 507C as well as a Trijicon RMR. Like I said, they're about a millimeter in difference in size. The dog tag part's just kind of a gag, but it comes with a little chain if you want it, but it's a mounting plate, comes with all the appropriate screws. And what you do is you replace the Glock plate and you can see here, it adds a nice little wedge up here and then it adds this right there. And I've been testing this thing and I haven't had one piece of brass hit the front of this optic since I started testing it. And it's really awesome. And he's also just a small business. So I will have a link over to his website if you guys want to check him out. But I think this is honestly awesome. But whenever you're going to mount it, obviously you want to make sure you have the right plate, unless you're going to mount to a bare slide, in which case you're just going to mount it to the bare slide. You want to make sure that you're using blue Loctite, not the red stuff. The red stuff, you will never be able to take the red dot off without cutting it off. Also, you only want to use a tiny bit on the threads of the screw. That's it. And it's super easy to go overboard with this. I've done it so many times on accident. And then later when I have to change my battery, especially with Trijicons, I strip out the screw. The other thing you want to do is get yourself a Wheeler torque wrench. I'll put a link for it over at the build list if you want it, if you want to check it out. I have one, but I don't know where it is right now. Otherwise I'd show it to you. You get one of those and you're going to set it to about 12 inch pounds. And that's as tight as you're gonna make the screws. Any lighter and the screws have a potential to back out as you're shooting the gun and the slide's reciprocating. Any tighter, now you risk stripping out your screws. So make sure that you only use about 12 inch pounds when you're mounting it and then you should be golden. Now, how do you choose between like a Trijicon and a HoloSun? Well, with the HoloSun, you kind of have two choices depending on which optic you go with. So for example, the 507C. has multiple radicals. You have a dot, you have a circle, or you have a circle with a dot in the middle. Then you have the 407, which is just a dot. I don't find myself using the circle at all, so I typically go get the 407 because they're usually a little bit cheaper. And I'll have links to where you can get them, and hopefully the places have them in stock, and hopefully I can find some promo codes for them over at the parts list. They're about $300 to $330 for the 507C, and they're about $275-ish for the 407C. And that's the same thing for the 407K, and 507K is the multiple reticles. And then there's the newest one, which is essentially a 507CX2 with the ACSS reticle and then this Vulcan thing. I'll get one and do a review on it. It's a whole thing. And I'll put some links to where you can check it out so you can read more about it. And then with the Trijicon RMR, there's a ton of different options. I'm just gonna stick to it like this. If you wanna get a Trijicon RMR for a carry gun, My personal humble opinion is either the RM06 or the RM07. The main difference between these two is one of them is a 3.25 MOA dot, which is the RM06, and the RM07 is a 6.5 MOA dot. Personally, for me, I prefer the 3.5 MOA dot because when you make it super bright, it makes the dot appear to be bigger. Whereas with this one, if you dim it, it doesn't make the dot any smaller. These are really good. The bigger dot is really good for, like, you know, self-defense distances and stuff. But if you're ever at the range and you want to shoot something at distance just to see what's up, it's a little bit more difficult with it. But either one of them is good. And I always prefer the Type 2. That's just me for handguns. Now, they got different RMR reticles and stuff for, you know, rifles and such. But just talking about the RM06 or the RM07, typically these are about the $500 range. I do have a link over at the build list, I believe, where you can get them for like $442, something like that. Maybe even cheaper. I'd have to go look again. Really a buy once, cry once kind of red dot. You're not gonna regret it. The only thing I don't like about the RMR now is the fact that I had to remove it to change the battery. So let me know, did I answer all your questions about red dots? I hope that I did. If I didn't, tell me down in the comments section and I will try to reply to those as soon as I can. And I hope that this video helps you guys on your journey with choosing a gun and choosing a red dot to go with your gun in the near future. But anyways, guys, I love you. You guys stay sexy.